Good morning. Good morning to our friends who are at home or traveling, wherever you may be. We're going to start differently before the call to worship. Three birthdays this morning. Lita, how old does she turn? 19. Ruby Chambers, who is not here, she partied hard yesterday for her 90th birthday. And someone else has a birthday. Any ideas? Could be Brooke. So we're gonna sing to Brooke for her 8th birthday today, and she's gonna act all shy. Ready?
Well, Sharon, is there somebody else's birthday?
Thursday. Twenty-five, 3 times plus 1.
Oh, don't make us do that kind of math. 25 times 3 plus...
Isn't it amazing, Roy, that you started this whole 25 times whatever to get your age and everyone else is doing it now?
It's like a challenge to do a math equation. Where's George Hill? George, my age is 9x times 10 to the 4th minus 20. I don't, you know,
how crazy would I go with that? Birthday this week? All right, well, we will sing for Brooke and Dave because they're here, right? And we know that Lita knows we love her, and Ruby definitely knows we love her. She had a great party yesterday.
So happy birthday, Brooke, Dave, Lita, Ruby.
Yes.
Okay. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Brooke, Dave, Lita, Ruby. Happy birthday to you. And many more.
They all have many more they can go. And we're going to have Carol send us, I'll have her send me a photo of Ruby in her sash and tiara. So if you didn't make it to the party, we'll post that on the church's Facebook page because she was adorable. So join me for the call to worship. Come and worship all who love and serve the Lord. Old timers and newcomers. Come as you are. Let us sing our hymn of praise.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. Our God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. Shout out your praise.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Come now to our time of joys and concerns. Are there any to share this morning? No one? Wow. Mark this day down. I do have a couple. Of course, we want to continue to keep the family of Roger Moore in our thoughts and prayers, and especially Brenda with her own health issues. I got a call this morning before church from Mr. Paul Usher. After a setback during the week and staying in the hospital a bit longer than he wanted, they will be home today. So that is good news. I don't think he has all the answers, but I'm sure there will be doctor's appointments. So he and Marcia will be home today, and hopefully they will take very long naps after that very long drive from Maryland. Are there any online? Fair enough. That's all I got. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you today, as always, giving thanks for our freedom to worship you and to remember that there are those in the world that don't have that luxury. God, we come to you today and we celebrate the birthdays mentioned. Life from you, lives that bring us all joy. God, we give thanks for the youth of the church and what they teach us. We give thanks for their questions, their wonderings. God, we pray for our community. God, it seems that in this community, violence is becoming ever more present, that people no longer speak with their mouths, they speak with violent actions. And so, God, we pray for our community. We pray for our first responders. And God, we pray for those who are in the various social services because we know that they are overloaded. God, we continue to pray for Roger's family and their time of grief. God, we continue to pray for Paul and for healing. And God, during a time of silent prayer, we lift up to you those things on our hearts and minds unmentioned this morning. God, hear our prayers. God, we pray and ask that you help make us better people, that you help make us better disciples. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord, who taught his disciples to pray by saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." This morning's scripture comes from Matthew 15, 10 to 20. Things that defile. Then he called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and that is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. Those are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile."
We come now, it's that time in the service this morning. We're so thankful and mindful of all the children who are joining us, whether in person or online today. And as we're going to explore a little bit about that passage from Scripture that Reverend Haley just read, I want to draw your attention up on the communion table in the center of the sanctuary. There is a small plastic Tupperware container sitting there. Within that Tupperware container is a collection of Kit Kats and Reese's. Would anybody like to go get one? Volunteer, feel if they are there to be offered. I offer them to you this morning. Feel free if you'd like to. Unless you don't like Reese's or Kit Kats, those were the two candies I had this morning. So I offer a Kit Kat or a Reese's to anybody who would like to. Don't be shy. Wait a minute. Hold on a second. Beth Strange. Hold on a second. Oh, wow. She read it quick. So you went up there and you have grabbed the candy, right? We were just going to open it and eat it, right? Correct. Now, did anybody notice that there is a bottle of hand sanitizer also sitting on the table? Did we think that we needed to clean our hands before we touched the candy in the bowl? This is a genuine question that is brought right out of the scripture reading this morning. Feel free to take your candy and sit down. Thank you for being, I don't know whether to say willing or unwilling people, but you enjoy your candy. Do we ever have times when we forget to wash our hands before we eat something? Have we ever done that before? I think that we have occasions when we forget to wash our hands. And now, it's a good thing that we wash and that we sanitize our hands before we eat things. But according to Jesus, there are some things that are far more important than washing our hands before we eat something. So you see, kids, in this passage of scripture that Reverend Haley read this morning from Matthew, the religious leaders during this time in Jesus' life were very concerned about cleanliness. They had many religious laws and traditions which they followed to make sure that nothing unclean went into their mouth. You cleaned your hands before you ate anything. So one day, some of the religious leaders, they asked Jesus why his disciples were not keeping their tradition of washing their hands before they ate. And Jesus answered them. He answered the religious leaders by telling them that what comes out of your mouth is more important than what you put into it. He said that the words that come out of your mouth come from your heart, and those words show whether you are clean or unclean. It has nothing to do with washing your hands before you put anything into your mouth. I want you to think about this. Some of you have probably heard the old children's rhyme, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me." We've heard that probably more than once. I know I have. And that sounds really nice, but I'm here to tell you, kids, it's not true. Words can hurt. We all can remember a time when we have been hurt by someone's mean and hateful words. God hears every word we say, and he knows every thought that we have in our hearts. It's very important for us to be careful about the things that we think and say, because hateful words come from an unclean heart. I want you to think about that, and we offer this prayer for you today. May God bless you and keep you. May God fill your heart with song and your mind with wisdom. May you learn every day how to be a disciple of Christ, to heal, to hope, to teach, and above all, to love. May you be our teachers just as we are yours. Amen.
Thanks, Wes. Passing out that candy was a bit like feeding the 5,000. Wasn't sure how it was going to work out. By the way, always, thank you, always before communion. Everyone happy with their candy? Good. It's always better to feed people chocolate than talk. Before we get into talking about the actual scripture for today, we need to go back to the beginning of Matthew chapter 15 so we can have context, so we can set the scene about what it is that Jesus is saying, where it comes from. Matthew 15, 1-9 states, "Then Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, 'Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands before they eat.' He answered them, 'And why do you break the commandment of God? for the sake of your tradition. For God said, honor your father and your mother, and whoever speaks evil of father or mother must surely die. But you said that whoever tells father or mother, whatever support you might have had from me is given to God, then that person need not honor the father. So for the sake of your tradition, you make void the word of God. You hypocrites! Exclamation point. Isaiah prophesied rightly about you when he said, this people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrine. So, some temple leaders have noticed that Jesus' disciples don't always wash their hands before eating. I will admit, I'm a bit like the temple leaders. If I'm eating with someone and there's a way to wash your hands, I might notice. But I won't judge you like this, I promise. Not washing their hands before eating isn't keeping with ritual cleanliness in Judaism, right? There are a lot of laws in Judaism, a lot of commandments about washing, even still for people who are Jewish. So they say, your friends aren't washing their hands all the time before they eat. And Jesus' response is probably not what they expect. He asks, why do you break the commandment of God for the sake of your tradition? Seems a little out of left field, but okay. Jesus isn't saying that hand washing isn't important, because it is, right? I think we can all agree. It is. And Jesus knows it is. But if these Pharisees and scribes are so bold as to point out that the disciples are not following the tradition of the elders, Jesus will point out that the Pharisees and scribes break a commandment of God just to uphold their own traditions. He tells them that they encourage people to turn away from their father and their mother. And in Judaism, huge no-no, right? Who do you honor after God? Your father and your mother. This is the commandment set out in the teachings of Exodus chapter 20, verse 12, Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 16, and Leviticus chapter 20, verse 9. So these temple leaders know how extremely important this is. It's in their holy scriptures. This isn't a new concept. So Jesus tells them, instead of following God's commandment, they encourage people to say to their parents, whatever support you might have had from me is given to God. Support's an interesting word, isn't it? It's not love. It's not caring. Whatever caring you might have had, whatever you love you might have had, whatever support you might have had. And so we may take away that Jesus is pointing out that these temple leaders are telling people to give more financially to the temple, that it's for God, and the leaders are lining their own pockets, when these people should also be helping take care of their parents in their old age, right? It's not a far stretch to imagine this, because we have plenty of scriptures where Jesus talks about the greed of temple leaders. We just had one few weeks ago. Jesus calls them hypocrites. Jesus and the disciples are helping people. If their help is any less holy because they don't wash their hands, is that really a thing? If Carol and I go have this Carol and the other Carol, three of us go have a meal together, and we need to discuss something, one of us has a problem, and we can't wash our hands right before the meal, but we're eating, and we're helping each other walk through this problem. Is that any less holy, any less helpful, because we didn't wash our hands? These temple leaders take advantage of people and claim their actions are holy, but hey, at least they remember to wash their hands before they eat. And then we get to this morning's scripture. Then he called the crowd to him. So we know that there are people there other than the disciples who have witnessed this interaction, this exchange of words. And Jesus says to them, listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but is what comes out of the mouth that defiles. Then the disciples approach and they say to him, do you know that the Pharisees took offense when you said that? He answered, every plant that my heavenly Father does not plant will be uprooted. We know that, right? We had the parable of the sower. We know all about plants at this point. And he says, let them alone. Leave them be, right? Don't interact with them about it anymore. They are the blind guides of the blind, and if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit. And then Peter says, explain this parable to us. And we have to wonder if Peter doesn't really get what Jesus is saying. It'd be kind of hard to miss his critique of temple leaders being the blind who don't see or understand the kingdom of God, who are leading other people into disaster because of their own greed, because of their own need for power. Or is Peter simply asking for clarification so he can make sure everyone understands? With Peter, just toss a coin, one or the other, right? Never know. And Jesus says, are you still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever enters the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? Makes sense? Anyone not know how the body works once you eat food? Thought not, right? Food in, fuel the body, waste later. Indoor plumbing and extensive sewer systems are a blessing in our day compared to what Jesus had, right? We all know, we've all probably had the experience of a not working toilet in our home at one point or the other. And it causes a lot of frustration and a lot of anxiety because that's how the body works and that's the one place. That's what Jesus is saying. So we know how the body works, so we understand that. What goes in comes out. Jesus continues by saying, but what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. This is what defiles, for out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person, but eating with unwashed hands does not defile. What comes out of the mouth and what actions are done by a person show the true nature of that person. Words and actions can defile a person, or they can be a blessing to others and that person as well, right? Now, I'm a firm believer that the Holy Spirit moves in interesting ways, and this week is a great example of that. I'd already picked this morning's scripture back in July, right, Wes? Picked it way in beginning of July. And this week, when I was ready to sermon prep, I was talking to Natalie, and I said, I've got, like, the lesson, right? Like, what the point of this is. But there needs to be something else. And as I was talking to her, she said, I forgot you got a letter. The sender of this letter to the church decided to remain anonymous. The return address says John 3:16, for God so loved the world. I agree. Though it's interesting, mailman, looking at you, that it was processed at the Metroplex facility in Michigan. So, does the sender live in Marion? Do they live in Michigan? Who knows? But that's the point of an anonymous letter, right? Are you glad I did research just for you? to know where that was, by the way. It's difficult to know if I received this letter alone or if it was a mass mailing to churches in the area. I did reach out to Carolyn Reed from the regional office, asked her if any of the disciples' churches had received letters like this. She said not that she knows of at this point. So you know this is going to be good. The sender of the letter, the anonymous sender of the letter, would like churches, pastors, and preachers to know that the King James Version of the Bible is the only acceptable translation and gives a number of reasons why. Right, Julie? You read the letter. If King James from the early 1600s is your preferred translation of the Bible, that's fantastic. I have no issues with that. But others may need something that's been translated into more modern language to fully understand, especially the youth. My 8-year-old niece just started third grade at a church school. They're reading the Adventure Bible in class, which is great. It's NIV, easy language for kids to understand. But one of her homework assignments was in the King James, and she said, I don't know what any of this says. Right? And I remember being the same way when I was a kid in church. So we know that God meets us where we are, right? Especially kids. If we want kids to know the Bible, love the Bible, they have to be able to understand it. Also, we have to remember that all English translations of the Bible are just that, translations, because what language did Jesus not speak? English. What language did the gospel writers not speak? English. No one who put the Bible together, and even the early Catholic Church, things were done in Latin, right? The next part of this letter talks about how preachers and pastors should preach according to the sender. That all should adhere strictly to the word of God, what the word of God means to the sender, that is. Which, I'm not really sure what that was, and Julie wasn't really sure what that was. It wasn't really a lot clear. But you all have had enough pastors to know that every preacher has their own style, right? Obviously, mine is more conversational. And every scripture usually has multiple lessons for congregations to learn from. I believe any time we gather and discuss the Word of God, the experience of God's people, even 5,000 years ago, right? We even discuss the Hebrews, and we try to figure out the lessons. What it meant for the community of God then, what it means for us, how are we tied? I believe we're adhering to the Word of God. We're supposed to learn. And then the section I anticipated, since I discovered it was an anonymous letter, it is titled, Women Pastors Are an Abomination to the Lord. You're not an abomination today, Irene, because you're not up here preaching. The sender follows that up with passages from Paul's letters about women being silent in church and only asking their husbands to explain things once they get home. Show of hands, women, if you do that. If you raise your hand, I know we're lying in church. That women should be submissive and obedient. Women should be voiceless. It's interesting that someone would write that preachers should adhere strictly to the word of God during their sermons, would also write and use the words of a man, Paul, and use the words from his letters to churches to back up their anti-female pastor point. Also, let us remember, and Ronnie was amazing with this morning, weren't you, Ronnie, that Paul mentions so many women in his letters. He gives them credit where it's due, especially in Timothy's family, right? Timothy, your mother and your grandmother were ministers in the word, right? So it doesn't really work what the person says. And as Wes brought up in the kitchen earlier, the letters have to be taken in context to each church. What was going on? Listen, if I had a dollar for every time someone told me I couldn't be a pastor or a preacher, couldn't be one, shouldn't be one, that I was an abomination, that I was an abomination to my husband and any other future mate, because I would think that I'm more important than them because of my position in the church, and so on and so on and so on. Well, I'd have enough money to have 10 dogs and a lot of land for them to roam on, right? I'd have more dogs than the Snyders. Am I upset that I received this letter? Here it is, by the way. No. Why? Because I'm used to it. It's the world in which I live and respond to my calling. I've had male ministers in Wabash tell me to my face that I shouldn't do my job. And that was in the Minister Association, by the way, where I was told I wasn't welcome. And this is not even the first anonymous letter I've received at a church telling me I shouldn't be a pastor. Should start really like framing them at this point. But did it upset me the first few times people said this to me? Of course. When you're in seminary and people say this to you, when churches deliberately won't hire you because you're female, yeah. But what I realized is what this morning's scripture says about what comes out of someone's mouth and what someone does defiles them, not me. The crap I say about Wes, which I don't, by the way, says more about me than it does about Wes. Words hurt, right? They do. If Roy didn't know I was always joking with him and he always thought I was serious, he might be offended. But we're friends, so it's fine. But words can often hurt. But with time, we can get past them. The person who wrote this letter and others who seek to harm others in speech and action show who they really are, how defiled, how corrupt, how dishonored they are, how evil human beings can be to one another. Jesus says, what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. The person who wrote the letter decided they didn't want anyone to know who they are, which should actually be a clue that they should have not sent it in the first place, right? I'm going to send Chuck some hateful mail, but I'm not going to put who it's from. Should be my first clue that I should not send Chuck some hateful mail. But they're not the only people who do things in secret. They can be harmful and hateful and get their satisfaction, you know, without having to ruin their public image. They can do harm without other people knowing about it, what they're doing. People get satisfaction out of that for some perverse reason. The same way people get satisfaction on Facebook saying whatever they want to someone just because it's online and not to their face. But even if other human beings don't know, God does, right? God knows our hearts and minds, and God knows what our intentions are when we hurt others. God knows when we hurt others deliberately and when we accidentally hurt people, right? God knows our heart. It's very clear to that. I mean, otherwise, look at the story of David. What would have been the point? Because he was not a nice person, but God knew his heart, right? And we have to keep reminding ourselves of that. And so God knows when we deliberately hurt other people. You can't hide from God. Let us learn from this morning's scripture and a letter sent in cowardice. Let's wash our hands, please. However, If we're in a position where we can't wash our hands before a meal or before a Kit Kat, it's not the end of the world. You imagine if you thought it was. Let's not send any anonymous letters that have a return address proclaiming God's love, 3:16, God so loved the world, when the letter is full of anything but. You cannot proclaim God's love and then be a jerk in the same paper. It doesn't work. And may the ways in which we speak to others and the ways in which we act toward others show that we really are followers of Christ. That we are the ones who show love instead of hate, kindness instead of greed, and a willingness to help instead of a willingness to want to control. This ends this morning's word. Thanks be to God. Let us sing our communion hymn. It has your name. I'll do it. It's fun. That is your name, right? It's all right. Okay. Come on up. This is not my first rodeo with elders. You have to talk to Natalie about that. Not my first rodeo with someone not necessarily supposed to be up here. All right. We're good. You all right? You're good.
Should I go first?
I'll go first. Okay. As always, we gather around this table and remember that on the night that he was arrested, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, blessed it, and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of the covenant for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we take this bread and we take this cup, we proclaim his death from this life as we know it until he comes again. The gifts of God for the children of God, all are welcome at the Lord's table.
Dear Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to meet together, to worship you
We thank you for the life that you died for us. We thank you for the bread symbolizing your body and the wine symbolizing your blood that you gave all that we might be able to live with the joy of salvation. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us take the bread. And the cup. That was good.
Son and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross.
Come in, Julie.
So, it was pointed out to me last week when I made the announcement about Barbie that here recently we've had Barbie make a appearance again. So I needed to let you all know that Barbie blessing is not the same thing as Barbie the doll. And I was told that there might have been a little bit of confusion about that. So for those of you who don't know about Barbie Christian Camp, it was started by our denomination 66 years ago and has been a faithful camp for all of our kids to be able to go to. It was sold in 2019. And the profits from that sale were then divided amongst the different denominations. And so that's why we have that $1,000 that we were wanting to use as a Barbie blessing that has nothing to do with Barbie. So I wanted to make that clear. And also, when I invited all of the congregation to come to the dinner last week, there is a catch to that. If you do come to the dinner, we will expect you to work also. So while we want you to come and help, we also do need volunteers as well. And there will be sign-up sheets out in the Narthex coming very soon. So just wanted to clear all that up. Please remember that it is us giving back to those people who tirelessly give to the community and everything that they do, such as Kendall School, providing the food and the counseling and everything for those kids, as well as for family services as well. So.
Thank you. My 8-year-old niece will tell you I suck at playing Barbies, so best not have Barbies there.
The worship service at First Christian Church is not sponsored by the movie Barbie at all.
I'm the most boring Barbie player there is on the earth.
Thank you for supporting the food pantry. And this last month, we've given the Salvation Army, or I've taken food over there, over $1,000, and and it's like you say, it's not my money, it's your money, and thanks for giving and continue to give to that. And I'll check this week and see how much is still in the account and try to get some more food over there. Their shelves were pretty bare when I was over there a couple weeks ago, so continue to support that project if you can.
Thank you, Dave. Any others? They didn't ask me to announce this, but Pat let me know last week that the number of kids that we are sending food home on weekends is up to 55 this year, which I think is like 30 more than when I first started here. And of course, food on the long weekends and breaks. So if you would like to give money, the church that we work with, they cannot financially give more. And so if you would like to also give more money for the Kendall School thing we do, the food on the weekends, talk to Pat. She's the one here. Or you can talk to Marcia or Angie. So trying to come up with a game plan on how best to proceed to help feed all of these kids and their families. And this week, Celebrating Families returns. And it's on Tuesdays now, so I know we are all used to them being here on Thursdays, so just remember the building in the evening, don't be here on Tuesdays. I will not be here next Sunday. You may clap, Dave. It's fine. I won't be here next Sunday, and most of the week I will be in my sister's pool in Georgia. Please don't find me. So if you have a pastoral care emergency, you can call the office, you can call Sharon, one of the elders, they're all listed in the newsletter. And if something major happens, we know Wes will help as well. And so I'll see you all when I return. Let us say the benediction together. Gathered, we seek God in our lives. Gathered, we hear from God's word. Gathered, we sing our praises to God. Gathered, we commune at the Lord's table. Dispersed, we shall share the love of God with the world. Go in peace, go in love, enjoy your lunch, and all God's children said, amen.